if I'm going to talk about industrial additive manufacturing and then the value chain, I have a lot of slides, so some slides I will skip a little bit faster than others. But just to start at the beginning again, it's So if you look at additive manufacturing, it's all about demand and about the additive manufacturing promise. And there's a lot in between regarding applications, integrations, from design for additive manufacturing towards the end of testing a product or selling a product. And in between, you have a lot of topics like standardization, quality management, strategies, post-processing, AM optimization. And for that additive manufacturing promise, there's a proposition to the high tech, maybe already seen before, like lightweight, free form, reliability, faster design, and lean logistics. Previous speakers also talked about it and talked about those topics, especially in the lean logistics or the digital warehousing. We see that that's improving regarding to the last years. But how does it come that certain propositions are already taken up by companies and others not? So if we look at innovation, it's about desirability of people, viability for businesses, and feasibility of the technology itself. And without it, around there you have like implementation, which is between feasibility and viability, between desirability and viability, ideation, and of course, between the technology and the people, you have inspiration. And with that come challenges, but there are also opportunities. So if you look at the challenges, it's depending on the TRL level, which was also mentioned before, because a commercial tool can, how do you call it, be commercial, but it still has a lot of flaws or a lot of challenges. Like within additive manufacturing, quality management are challenges, data sharing, IP, etc., which are not standardized yet. Also, materials are not always specially developed for technology, but there we see also improvement, which you also saw today in one of the presentations. And the challenges lie in AM processes, it's like predicting, controlling, and qualifying. And all those challenges have an impact on the acceptance of technology. And of course, you have to have the right people with the knowledge, experience, and the belief. But that's all change management, which has to be managed within a company or with, in between organizations. And if you look at the adaptations, markets are developing and business models are changing. So how to work together if you both have a proposition and want to sell your proposition into the market, for example, hardware and software solutions, or like a service bureau selling the production of your parts. But also opportunities are there. So if you look into feasibility and viability, you have implementation. And implementation has a lot to do with process innovation and improving software and equipment for the return on investment. So your total cost of ownership. Somebody has to pay for that technology and wants to earn money back with it. Also, people are using a certain technology faster when the ease of use is very low. So when it's easy, for example, with your phone to use an app and to order something. For that, you need improved software and materials and equipment for designing, for example, in additive manufacturing. And for the acceptance, yeah, your skills and your tools for functional parts in the end are important. So you come to a some 4 points which are important. You need a kind of world-class infrastructure with integrated IAM solutions, latest AM software, state-of-the-art printers. You want to learn and still do research for the low TRL level, where we also saw some examples in our previous presentations with regard to applications or materials and parameters. But we also need to educate our workforce, but ourselves, companies, how to use and work with additive manufacturing by workshop, demonstrator, math classes, or even these presentations that are currently going on. And of course, you need a kind of eco-structure where you know that you can find the right people for certain challenges. And wherefore do we need this all in place? Because it's all about a customer. And what does the end customer want? They want a working functional part. And it doesn't matter for them how that part is being made, as long as it functions as they want. But if you look at additive manufacturing, they look into or shorter lead times, spare parts, so your inventory is lower, or the process chain is much shorter, or you need less time to assembly a part, or it needs to be more cost efficient, directly or indirectly, because indirectly your labor cost or quality cost can also give an improvement in your profits. And at least they want to have the same or better quality. And they don't want to run higher risk on that quality, because later when your product is into the market, you don't want to have those products back, sent back to you because they are not qualified. Now, if you look at the customer and the additive manufacturing design, we get a lot of questions. Which functions need the product have? What do we find important? What may the cost be? And that can be around a lot of things like strength, flow optimization, material complexity, or designer freedom. And a engineer, which is then working in the additive manufacturing area, has to have all those things in his mind. So, okay, how do I manage surface finish? How do I, which machines will I use? What kind of design restrictions are there? So we have a kind of multi-physical area where you need to think about all those functional aspects, where also we see that more software design is being done to make it easier for a engineer. Now, if we look at materials, we also see that slowly more materials being available for certain applications or for certain functions. For example, with BASF UltraFuse, yeah, you can create functional prototypes or jigs or end-use parts or replacement parts, just looking at the material itself and in conjunction with the chosen technology. And also, for example, stainless steel is being used as a filament for end-use parts, but it's slowly coming up. Of course, also their competitors, like DSM, has also its special materials for certain functional parts. Functional proto parts, spare parts, and end-use parts. So in the area, if you look at the value chain, materials is a very important area to see and to look at in combination with the chosen technology. Now, coming back to quality control, depending on the technology, there are different requirements, but you start with the quality management or quality control on your material. Material characterization, material specification, analysis, validation. It's also was presented before in one of the previous presentations. Now, if the material is right, then your equipment needs to be right. It has to be calibrated. It has to perform in the right way. And if material and equipment are in the right state, then also your process needs to be controlled with the parameters, the controlling and the monitor. And then, if those are all right, then your product can be evaluated towards geometry, roughness, with the different measurement equipment. But quality monitoring is also about data. And data and digitalization is I think, one of the big facts which now AM has a high, how do you call that, a high importance in the market. Because without the digitalization, there would not be additive manufacturing, because it's making some things easier. And if you look at quality monitoring and the prediction systems, now the development of software for that and the tracking and change, the tracking of the data and its process is also being developed, where the focus is now on implementing quality control measures in the process chain. So looking at the laser or looking at the heat source, and then see, okay, what will be the outcome. But also the quality monitoring for building parts along the process chain. So if we only have printing the part, you also need to post-process or maybe pre-process. So that's also something that you need to monitor to come to manufactured broadcast products. Now, if we look at the design for additive manufacturing process, I don't know if it's readable on everybody's screen, but it starts with data management. Then, of course, you go to design and engineering, work preparation, printing, the quality management, of course, and the AM integration with your other processes or other technologies. And during that full chain, which is a process chain, but it's also a value chain, because everywhere value is being added. And you get a kind of feedback or reverse engineering towards the start of the process. I now have a sheet which is more text than pictures, because these are 3 points where I think which will be become more important in the next coming years. So the use of hybrid manufacturing, systems where additive and subtracting manufacturing are combined in the same machine, which also has its lot of challenges, but also its opportunities. And implementation of AM systems as part of an end-to-end production workflow, which I will go further in depth in the next sheet. And of course, implementation of AM systems in the traditional production processes. So how do you implement AM systems within your company? And the integration is not only on hardware, but also on software, where you look at CAD/CAM, CIA software, simulation, and additive manufacturing execution systems with product lifecycle management tools. So it's about digitalization. It starts with a digital inventory of approved AM parts, where you say, okay, I want to order them, I want to schedule them, and track using connectivity. Of course, these are parts that then are already designed for additive manufacturing. So if you look at an end-to-end solution, you have to have a kind of agile PLM system, agile ERP system, agile mesh system, where you start with identifying your opportunities for parts within your company or within another company. So you need to see, okay, which parts would be applicable for this AM technology. Then, of course, you need to do your design cyclist, where you say, okay, is it printable? And depending on the software that the company is using, Fusion or NX or AutoCAD or other CAD systems, you also need to be flexible to integrate those design software into your workflow. Of course, then you get your orders. So how do you organize your supply chain management? Are you doing it all by yourself, or are you just buying the parts from a service provider? And you want to do that also in a fast way, because then your throughput time is lower. Of course, then you get the preparations, the scheduling, and of course the manufacturing. And for example, this is an example from TrioMind, where we work together with. So just a small in-depth on the Agile PLM is that you manage your AM part data across the organization through the whole product life cycle, where you can look into, okay, which parts will be applicable for additive manufacturing? What shall I do with my inventory? How do I integrate it within my modules? If it's a part which is existing from a bigger machine or a bigger module. And how do I organize that? So there was one example from the Deutsche Bahn, where with automated software, they could improve their search for suitable parts within their company. So to get a good result on what kind of products would be in scope and how can we assess those parts. And what we see, if you automate that process with software, you can gain a lot of money by reducing that time. And for Deutsche Bahn, it meant that a part rollout will save the Deutsche Bahn 90,000 euros. I will not play the video because of the time, but maybe I share the link later that you can look into it, where with only using photos and a kind of app, a person within a train, the engineer, could look at some possibilities, make a photo and create a business case on it. So it's automated. And it's also part of your value chain. So if we look at the value chain, it's about company competitive advantage, impact on the customer value. It also is depending on customer new behavior, habits, and demand patterns. And of course, the disruption, which was also mentioned in one of the previous presentation, by the new technologies and the business models. And of course, which industry service and technologies are important. So if we look at the advantages and customer value, on the left side, you see some examples of Signify, where they have their modular lamps, which you can create yourself, and where they will print the whole lamp according to your choices. But it's about your customer value, plus they have an advantage that they know a lot about lighting. And since the last years, they also know a lot about printing. One of the advantages which is also impacting the new customer new behavior is sustainability and recycling, which becomes more important. I believe there will be a in Germany there will be passed a bill where throw away plastics will not be allowed anymore. So that will have an impact on customer behavior, but also on your value chain. So recycling of polycarbonates, which Signify is doing, is a good move into the direction of new behavior and new customer value. Also, special tooling, which is important for handling all the different products. So mass production, yeah, okay, that's a challenge, but not if you're using the tooling for mass production, where you can exchange wear parts or spare parts to secure the uptime of machines, which sometimes can result in a cost saving for 70 to 90% per part. If we look at customer new behavior, we also saw the change regarding the COVID crisis, where a lot of parts are in a fast development mode, which also was presented in the first presentation. But there are also a lot of questions regarding that process. For example, how reliable are those parts? Were they qualified? How is everybody who are producing or using the products, how are they educated? And what kind of risks do you run? So if you then look into production, where you look into integrated 3D print farms, you want to provide a kind of safe quality environment with integrated software. So on an industrial additive manufacturing level, where you can print polymers or metals in a kind of modular and end-to-end production cluster. And of course, we want to innovate further. So within AMPC, we have kind of innovation project running in Eindhoven as our value proposition, where we have a field lab multi-material 3D, where we look into applications, pilot lines, and automizing of additive manufacturing processes. It's the called, multi-material 3D field lab. It is within Eindhoven in the Brinkport Industry Campus, where there are bigger contract manufacturers, there are schools. We run innovation programs and there are startups. If we look at the value chain or the value proposition there, it's all about the ecosystem. So you need the right ecosystem to have all your ingredients for the right business cases. So it's about collaboration. So we want to attract the right talent, have the right business development, creating the customer value, and have the right innovation development within that factory of the future, where we share facilities, exchange our network, and look how we can create new business within new business models.